over to our reading playlist. Oh, it's starting off with a good one. Okay. And then... get my notebook out. Mom, if you could just keep an eye on them while I read, that'd be great. Thank you.
Where's my pen? Ugh!
You know what? We'll just get a new pen out. Okay. I just want to sing along to this song, but there's no lyrics. Okay. We left off with chapter 43. Selena stood in the gaming room, staring at the pianoforte as she heard Kael quickly leave. She hadn't played in weeks. Originally, it had been just because she didn't have time. Because Archer and the tomb and Kael had occupied every moment of her day. Then Nehemia had died, and she hadn't gone into this room once, hadn't wanted to look at that instrument, hadn't wanted to hear or make music ever again. Shoving the encounter with Kael out of her mind, Selena slowly folded back the lid of the pianoforte and stroked the ivory keys. But she couldn't push down, couldn't bring herself to make a sound. Nehemia should have been here, to help with Yellowlegs and the riddle, to tell her what to do with Kael, and to smile as Selena played something particularly clever for her. Nehemia was gone, and the world, it was moving on without her. When Sam had died, she had tucked him into her heart, tucked him in alongside her other beloved dead, whose names she kept so secret she sometimes forgot them. But Nehemia wouldn't fit. It was as if her heart was too full of the dead, too full of those lives that had ended well before their time. She couldn't seal Nehemia away like that, not when that blood-stained bed and those ugly words still haunted her every step, every breath. So Selena just hovered at the pianoforte, tracing her fingers over the keys again and again, and let the silence devour her. An hour later, Selena stood before the strange second staircase at the end of the forgotten hall of the ancient records, a clock chiming somewhere far in the library above. The images of Faye and Flora danced along the firelit stairwell, spiraling out of sight, down and down into the unknown depths. She'd found the walking dead almost immediately, discarded on a lonely table between some stacks. As though it had been waiting for her, and it had been the work of a few minutes to find a spell inside that claimed to unlock any door. She'd quickly memorized it, practicing a few times on a locked chest. It had taken all of her self-control not to scream when she heard the lock snap free the first time. Or the second. It was no wonder Nehemia and her family kept such power a secret. And no wonder the King of Adderland had sought it out for himself. Staring down into the stairwell, Selena touched Damaris, then looked at the two jeweled daggers hanging from her belt. She was fine. No reason to be nervous. What sort of evil did she expect to find in a library, of all places? Surely the king had better places to hide his dark dealings. At best, she'd find more hints as to whether he had any word keys and where he kept them. At worst, she would run into the cloaked person she'd seen outside the library that night. But the glowing eyes she'd glimpsed on the other side of that door belonged to a rodent of some sort, nothing more. And if she was wrong, well, whatever it was, after taking down the Ritterak, this shouldn't be too hard, right? Right? Selena stepped forward, pausing on the landing. Nothing. No feelings of terror, no otherworldly warnings, not a thing. She took another step, then another, holding her breath as she wound around the staircase until she could no longer see the top. She could have sworn the etchings on the walls moved all around her, that the beautiful, feral faces of the Fae turned to look as she passed. The only noises were her footsteps and the whisperings of the torch flame. A chill ran down her spine, and Selena stopped at the dark void of the hallway came into view. She was at the sealed iron door a moment later. She didn't give herself the luxury of reconsidering her plan as she took out her pieces of chalk and traced two word marks onto the door, whispering the accompanying words at the same time. They burned in her tongue, but as she finished speaking, she heard a faint, dull thud as something in the door slid open. She swore under her breath. The spell truly worked. She didn't want to think about all that implied, about how it was able to work on iron, the one element supposedly immune to magic. and not when there were so many awful spells contained in The Walking Dead, spells to summon demons, to raise the dead, to torture others until they begged for death. With a firm tug, she yanked open the door, wincing as it whined across the gray stone floor. A stale, cold breeze ruffled her hair. She drew Damaris. After checking and double-checking that she could not be locked inside, she crossed the threshold. Her torch revealed a small staircase of about 10 steps, which led down to another long, narrow passageway. Cobwebs and dust filled every inch of it, but it wasn't the neglect look of the place that made her pause. Rather, it was the doors, the dozens of iron doors that lined both sides of the hallway, all as nondescript as the door behind her, all revealing nothing of what might be behind them. At the opposite end of the hall, another iron door gleamed dully in the torchlight. What was this place? She descended the stairs. It was so silent, as if the very air held its breath. She held her torch high, Damaris in her other hand, and approached the first iron door. It had no handle, the surface marked only by a single line. The door across from it had 2 marks, numbers 1 and 2. Odd numbers on the left, even on the right. She kept moving, igniting torch after torch, brushing away the curtains of cobwebs as she walked farther down the hall. The numbers on the doors rose. Is this some sort of dungeon? But the floor held no traces of blood, no remnants of bones or weapons. It didn't even smell that bad. Just dusty. Dry. She tried opening one of the doors, but it was firmly locked. All of the doors were locked, and some instinct told her to keep them that way. Her head throbbed slightly with the beginnings of a headache. The hallway went on and on, until she reached the door at the far end. The cells on either side numbered 98 and 99. Beyond them was a final, unmarked door. She set her torch in a bracket inside beside the last door and grabbed the ring on the door to pull it open. This one was significantly lighter than the first, but also locked. And unlike the doors lining the hall, this one seemed to ask her to unlock it, as though it needed to be opened. So Selena sketched the unlocking spell again, the chalkbone white against the ancient metal door. The door yielded without a sound. Perhaps these were Gavin's dungeons, from the time of Brannon. That would explain the fey depictions on the staircase above. Perhaps he'd used these iron-gated cells to imprison the demon soldiers of Erewhon's army, or the wicked things Gavin and his warband hunted down. Her mouth went dry as she passed through the second door and ignited the torches along the way. Again, the light revealed a small set of stairs leading down into a hallway, yet this one veered to the right and was significantly shorter. There was nothing in the shadows, just more and more locked iron doors on either side. It was so, so quiet. She walked until she reached the door on the other end of the hall. 66 cells this time, all sealed shut. She unlocked the end door with the word marks. She entered the third passageway, which also made a sharp right turn, and found it to be even shorter, 33 cells. A fourth hallway veered right again, and she counted 22 cells. The slight throbbing in her head turned into a full-on pounding, but it was so far to her rooms, and she was here already. Selena paused before the fourth end door. It's a spiral, a labyrinth, bringing you deeper and deeper inside, farther underground. She bit her lip but unlocked the door. 11 cells. She increased her pace and swiftly reached the fifth door. 9 cells. She approached the sixth door and halted. A different sort of chill went through her as she stared at the sixth portal. The center of the spiral? As the chalk met the iron door to form the word marks, a voice in the back of her mind told her to run. And though she wanted to listen, she opened the door anyway. Her torch revealed a hallway in ruin. Parts of the walls had caved in, and the wooden beams were left in splinters. Cobwebs stretched between the broken shafts of wood, and tattered scraps of cloth impaled upon rock and beam swayed in the slight breeze. Death had been here, and not too long ago. If this place were as ancient as Gavin and Brannon, most of the cloth would be dust. She looked at the 3 cells that lined the short hallway. There was one more door at the end, which hung crookedly on its one remaining hinge. Darkness filled the void beyond. But it was the third cell that held her interest. The iron door to the third cell had been smashed, its surface dented and folded in upon itself, but not from the outside. Selena raised Damaris before her as she faced the open cell. Whoever had been within had broken loose. A quick sweep of her torch across the threshold revealed nothing save for bones, piles of bones, most of them splintered beyond recognition. She snapped her attention back to the hallway. Nothing moved. Gingerly, she stepped into the cell. Iron chains dangled from the walls, broken off where manacles should have been. The dark stone was covered in white marks, dozens and dozens of long, deep gouges in groups of 4. Fingernails. She turned around to face the broken cell door. There were countless marks on it. How could someone make such lines in iron? In stone? She shuddered and quickly stepped out of the cell. She glanced back the way she had come, which glowed with the torches she'd lit, and then at the dark, open space that led onward. You're near the center of the spiral. Just see what it is. See if it yields any answers. Elena said to look for clues. She swung Damaris in her hand a few times, only to loosen her wrist, of course. Rolling her neck, she entered the gloom. There were no torch brackets here. The seventh portal revealed only a short passageway and one open door. An eighth gate. The walls on either side of the eighth door were damaged and claw-marked. Her head gave a violent throb, then quieted as she stepped nearer. Beyond the portal lay a spiral staircase that led upward, so high that she couldn't see the top. A straight ascent into darkness. But to where? The stairwell stank, and she held Damaris before her as she ascended the steps, taking care to avoid the fallen stones that littered the ground. Up and up and up she climbed, grateful for all her training. Her headache only grew worse, but when she reached the top, she forgot about fatigue, forgot about pain. She raised the torch, shimmering obsidian walls surrounded her, reaching high, 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 so high that she couldn't see the ceiling. She was inside some sort of chamber at the bottom of a tower. Twining through the strange stone walls, greenish veins glittered in the torchlight. She had seen this material before. Seen it. The king's ring. The ring on Parrington's finger. And Kane's. She touched the stone and a shock went through her, her head pounding so badly she gagged. The eye of Elena gave a pulse of blue light, but quickly died, as if the light itself had been sucked toward the stone and devoured. She staggered back toward the stairs. Gods above, what is this? As if in response, a boom shuddered through the tower, so loud that she jumped back. It echoed and echoed, turning metallic. She raised her gaze to the darkness above. I know where I am, she whispered as the sound subsided. The clock tower. And that was chapter 43. Lilith and Jinx, if you're talking about this song, it's because it is a popular song. It's just the musical number for it. Hey mom, could you fill this with water?
I think I can see it longer and all that.
Potentially as long as she doesn't hiss and freak out. Make a deal with God. Oh, the first song today. Enemy, but yeah. Avocado. Hey. Come here. Over here. Leave her be. Come on, go lay down. Come on. Come on, don't look over there. It doesn't help that when you got up, Avocado followed you. Come on.
It's okay, Mira.
My mom is trying to coax Mira into here.
Do this a little closer?
Yeah. Come on, Avocado. Lay down. Lay down, baby. Animals, am I right? Avocado! Come here, baby. Come on. Lay down over here. Come on.
Come on, baby girl. It's okay. You don't need to say hi to the kitty right now. I know you want to give her kisses, but you can't. Not right now. Okay?
Okay. Hop. Okay, 1424. Okay, moving on to chapter 44. Dorian stared at the odd spiral staircase. Selena had found the legendary catacombs beneath the library. Of course she had. If there were anyone in Aurelia who could find something like that, it would be Selena. He'd been just about to go to lunch when he'd seen Selena strut into the library, a sword strapped across her back. Perhaps he would have let her go about her business, were it not for her braided hair. Selena never tied back her hair, unless she was fighting, and when she was about to get messy. It wasn't spying, and it wasn't sneaking. Doreen was merely curious. He followed her through long-forgotten hallways and rooms, always staying far behind. Keeping his steps silent, as Kael and Brulo had taught him years ago. He'd followed until Selena had disappeared down that staircase with a suspicious glance over her shoulder. Yes, Selena was up to something, and so Doreen had waited. 1 minute, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, before following after her, to make it seem like an accident if their paths crossed. And now what did he see? Nothing but junk. Old parchment and books tossed around. Beyond was a second spiral staircase, lit in the same manner as the previous one. A chill went through him. He didn't like any of this. What was Selena doing here? As if in answer, his magic screamed at him to run in the opposite direction, to find help. But the main library was a long way off, and by the time he could get there and back, something might happen. Something might already have happened. Doreen quickly descended the staircase, and found a dimly lit hallway with a single door left ajar, two marks written on it in chalk. When he saw the lined cell hallway beyond, he froze. The iron reeked somehow, and made his stomach turn. Selena? He called down the hallway. No response. Selena? Nothing. He had to tell her to get out. Whatever this place was, neither of them should be here. Even if the power in his blood wasn't screaming it, he would have known. He had to get her out. Doreen descended the staircase. Selena half ran, half jumped down the stairs, getting away from the interior of the clock tower as fast as she could. Though it had been months since she encountered the dead during the duel with Kane, the memory of being slammed into the dark wall of the tower was still too near. She could see the dead grinning at her, and recalled Elena's words on Samhuin about the 8 guardians in the clock tower, and how she should stay far from them. Her head ached so badly that she could barely focus on the steps beneath her. What had been in there? This had nothing to do with Gavin, or Brannon. Maybe the dungeons had been built then, but this, all of this, had to be connected to the king, because he had built that clock tower. Built it out of obsidian the gods forbade, and stone they greatly feared. But the keys were supposed to be small, not mammoth like the clock tower, not... Selena hit the bottom of the clock stairs and froze as she beheld the passage that contained the destroyed cell. The torches had been extinguished. She has not done that before. Are you being a silly girl? Anyways. As Selena hit the bottom of the clock stairs and froze as she beheld the passage that contained the destroyed cell. The torches had been extinguished. She looked behind her, toward the clock tower. The darkness seemed to expand, reaching for her. She wasn't alone. Clutching her own torch, keeping her breathing steady, she crept along the passage. Nothing. No sounds, no hint of another person in the passage. But, halfway down she stopped again and set down the torch. She'd marked all the turns, counted her steps as she came here. She knew the way in the dark, could find her way back blindfolded. And if she wasn't alone down here, then her torch was a beacon, and she was in no mood to be a target. She put out the torch with a grind of her heel. Complete darkness. She lifted Damaris higher, adjusting to the dark. Only it wasn't wholly black. A faint glow issued from her amulet. A glow that allowed her to see only dim shapes, as if the darkness were too strong for the eye. The hair on the back of her neck rose, the only other time she'd seen the amulet glow like that. Feeling along the wall with her other hand, not daring to turn around, she eased back toward the library. There was a scrape of nail against stone, and then the sound of breathing. It was not her own. It peered out from the shadows of the cell, clutching at its cloak with its taloned hands. Food. For the first time in months, she was so warm, so teeming with life. It skittered out of the cell past her as she continued to her blind retreat. Since they had locked it down here to rot, since they had gotten tired of playing with it, it had forgotten so many things. It had forgotten its own name, forgotten what it used to be. But it now knew more useful things, better things, how to hunt, how to feed, how to use those marks to open and close doors. It had paid attention during the long years. It had watched them make the marks. And once they had left, it had waited until it knew they weren't coming back, until he was looking elsewhere and had taken all his other things with him. And then it had begun opening the doors, one after another. Some shred of it remained mortal enough to always seal those doors shut, to come back here and form the marks that again locked the doors, to keep it contained. But she had come here. She had learned the marks, which meant she had to know what had been done to it. She had to have been a part of it, the breaking and shattering, and then brutal rebuilding. and since she had come here, it ducked into another shadow and waited for her to walk into its claws. Selena stopped her retreat as the breathing halted. Silence. The blue light around her grew brighter. Selena put a hand to her chest. The amulet flared. It had been stalking the little men who lived above for weeks now, contemplating how they would taste. Avocado! Come here. I know, backing up is hard for you. It had been stalking the little men who lived above for weeks now, contemplating how they would taste. But there was always that cursed light near them, light that burdened sensitive eyes. There was always something that sent it skittering back here to the comfort of the stone. Rats and crawling things had been its only food for too long, their blood and bones thin and tasteless. But this female, it had seen her twice before, first with that same faint blue light around her throat, then a second time, when it hadn't seen her as much as smelled her from the other side of that iron door. Upstairs, the blue light had been enough to keep it away. Blue light that had tasted of power. But down here, down in the shadows of the black, breathing stone, that light was diminished. Down here, now that it had put out the torches she ignited, there was nothing to stop it, and no one to hear her. It had not forgotten, even in the twisted pathways of its memory, what had been done to it on that stone table. With a dripping maw, it smiled. The eye of Elena burned bright as a flame, and there was a hiss in her ear. Selena whirled, striking before she could get a good look at the cloaked figure behind her. She glimpsed only a flash of withered skin and jagged, stumpy teeth before she sliced Damaris across its chest. It screamed like nothing she had ever heard as the ragged clothes ripped, revealing a bony, misshapen chest peppered with scars. It slammed a clawed hand into her face as it fell, its eyes gleaming from the light of the amulet. The animal's eyes, capable of seeing in the dark. The person, creature, from the hallway, from the other side of the door. She didn't even see where she had wounded it, as she hit the ground, blood rushing from her nose and filled her mouth. She staggered into a sprint back toward the library. She leapt over fallen beams and chunks of stone, letting the eye light her way, barely keeping her footing as she slipped on bones. The creature barreled after her, tearing through the obstacles as if they were no more than a gossamer curtains. It stood like a man, but it wasn't a man. No, that face was something out of a nightmare. And its strength, to be able to shove aside those fallen beams as though they were stalks of wheat? The iron doors had been there to keep this thing in, and she had unlocked all of them. She dashed up the short stairs and through the first doorway. As she veered left, it caught her by the back of her tunic. The cloth tore. Selena slammed into the opposite wall, ducking as it lunged for her. Damaris sang and the creature roared, falling back. Black blood squirted from the wound across its abdomen, but she hadn't cut deep enough. Surging to her feet, blood running down her back from where its claws had punctured, Selena drew a dagger with her other hand. The hood had fallen off the creature, revealing what looked like a man's face. Looked like, but no longer was. His hair was sparse, hanging off his gleaming skull in clumpy strings, and his lips. There was such scarring around its mouth as though someone had ripped it open and sewn it shut, and then ripped it open again. The creature pushed a gnarled hand against its abdomen, panting through those brown, broken teeth as it looked at her. Looked at her with such hatred that she couldn't move. It was such a human expression. "What are you?" she gasped, swinging Damaris as she took another step back. But suddenly, it began clawing at itself, tearing at its dark robes, pulling out its hair, pushing against its skull, as if it would reach in and rip something out. And the shrieks it made, the rage and despair. The creature had been in the castle hallway, which meant this thing, this person, it knew how to use the word marks too. And with its unnatural strength, no mortal barrier would keep it contained. The creature tipped its head back, and its animal eyes settled on her again, fixating, a predator anticipating the taste of its prey. Selena turned and ran like hell. Dorian had just passed through the third door when he heard the screams of something not human. A series of crashing noises filled the passageway, and the bellowing was cut short with each slam. "Selena?" Dorian yelled in the direction of the commotion. Another slam. "Selena!" Then, "Dorian, run!" The high-pitched shriek that followed Selena's command shook the walls. The torches sputtered. Dorian drew his rapier as Selena came flying up the stairs, blood leaking from her face, and slammed the iron door shut behind her. She raced toward him, a sword in one hand, a dagger in the other. The amulet on her neck glowed blue, like the hottest fire. Selena was upon him in a second. The iron door burst open behind them, and the thing that came out of was not of this earth. It couldn't be. It looked like something that used to be a man, but was twisted and dried and broken, with hunger and madness written on every protruding bone in its body. Gods, oh gods, what had she awoken? They sprinted down the hall, and Dorian swore as he beheld the steps up to the next door, the time it would take for them to climb the stairs. But Selena was fast, and months of training had made her strong. To his eternal humiliation, as they hit the bottom of the stairs, she grasped him by the collar of his tunic, half hauling him up the steps. She hurled him into the hallway beyond the threshold. But then, the thing shrieked. Dorian turned in time to see its broken teeth glistening as it leapt up the stairs. Lightning swift, Selena slammed the iron door shut in the creature's face. Only one more door. He could picture the landing that led back to the first hallway, then the spiral staircase, then the second staircase, and... what then? When they reached the main library, what could they do against this thing? As Dorian saw the naked terror on Selena's face, he knew she wondered the same. Selena threw Dorian into the hallway and then hurled herself backwards, slamming into the last iron door that separated the thing's lair from the rest of the library. She put her weight into it and saw stars as the creature barreled into the other side. Gods, it was strong. Strong and wild and unyielding. For a moment, she stumbled away, and it tried to fling open the door, but Selena lunged, throwing her back against it. Its hand caught in the door, and the creature bellowed, latching its claws into Selena's shoulder as she pushed and pushed. Blood ran from her nose, mingling with the blood running down her shoulders. The claws dug in farther. Dorian rushed to the door, bracing his back against it. He panted, gaping at her. They had to seal the door. Even if this thing was intelligent enough to know the word marks, they had to buy some time for themselves. She had to give Dorian enough time to get away. They would run out of strength soon, and the thing would break through and kill them, and whoever else got in its path. There had to be a lock somewhere, some way to shut it, to slow it down, just for a moment. Push! She breathed to Dorian. The creature gained an inch, but Selena shoved hard, drawing in the strength of her legs. It roared again, so loudly that she thought blood would pour from her ears. Dorian swore viciously. She glanced at him, not even feeling the pain of the talons embedded in her skin. Sweat ran down Dorian's brow as the metal began to heat along the edges of the door, glowing red, then fizzing. Magic was here. Magic was working right now, trying to seal the door against the creature, but it wasn't coming from her. Dorian's eyes were scrunched in concentration, his face deathly pale. She'd been right. Dorian did have magic. This was the information Yellowlegs had wanted to sell to the highest bidder. Sell to the king himself. It was knowledge that could change everything. It could change the world. Dorian had magic, and if he didn't stop, he was going to burn himself out in the iron door. The door suffocated Dorian. He was in a coffin with no air. His magic couldn't breathe. He couldn't breathe. Selena swore as the creature gained ground. Dorian didn't even know what he was doing, only that he needed to seal this door. His magic had chosen the method. He pushed with his legs, pushed with his back, pushed with his magic to the breaking point as he sought to weld the door, spinning, heat, strangling. The magic slipped from him. The creature pushed hard, sending Dorian staggering forward, but Selena threw herself harder against the door as he regained his balance. Selena's blade lay a few feet away, but what good was a sword? They had no hope of escaping with their lives. Selena's eyes met with his, and the question all too visible on her bloodied face. What have I done? Still gripped by the creature's talons, Selena couldn't even move as Dorian made a sudden lunge for Damaris. The creature tried again to break free, and the prince swung, making direct contact with its wrist. Its shriek penetrated her bones, but the door slammed shut completely. Selena stumbled, the beast's dismembered hand protruding from her shoulder, but she shoved back against the door as the creature again launched itself at it. "What the hell is it?" Dorian barked, throwing his weight back against the door. "I don't know," Selena breathed. Not having the luxury of a healer, she ripped the filthy hand from her shoulder, biting down on her scream. "It was down there," she panted. Another thud from behind the door. "You can't seal that door with magic. We need to seal this another way, and find something that would outsmart whatever unlocking spells this creature knew. Some way to keep it from getting out." She choked on the blood running from her nose into her mouth, and spat it onto the floor. "There is a book, The Walking Dead. It'll have the answer." Their eyes met and held. A line stretched taut between them, a moment of trust and a promise of answers from both of them. "Where's the book?" Dorian asked. "In the library. It'll find you. I can hold this for a few moments." Not needing it to make sense, Dorian bolted upstairs. He ran through stack after stack, his fingers reading the titles, faster and faster, knowing each second drained her strength. He was about to bellow his frustration when he ran past a table and beheld a large black volume resting upon its surface. The Walking Dead. She had been right. Why was she always right in her own odd way? He grabbed the book and hurtled to the secret chamber. She had shut her eyes and her teeth were red with her own blood as she gritted them. Here, Dorian said. Without needing her to ask, he shoved himself into the door as she dropped to the floor and grabbed the book to her hands. Her hands trembled as she flipped a page, then another, and another. Her blood splattered onto the text. To bind or contain, she read aloud. Dorian peered down at the dozens of symbols on the page. This will work? He asked. I hope so, she wheezed, already moving, clutching the open book in one hand. Once the spell is cast, just passing over that threshold will hold it in place long enough to kill it. She dipped her fingers into the wounds on her chest, and he could only gape as she made the first mark, and then the second, turning her battered body into an inkwell, as she drew mark after mark around the door. But for it to pass over the threshold, Dorian panted, we'd have to... Open the door, she finished for him, nodding. He shifted so she could reach to draw above his head, their breath mingling. Selena let out a long breath as she made the last mark, and suddenly they glowed a faint blue. He held himself against the door, even as he felt the iron go rigid. You can let go, she breathed, angling the sword. Let go, and get the hell behind me. At least she didn't insult him by telling him to flee. With a final breath, he left the way. The creature slammed into the door, flinging it open. And just like she had said, it froze on the threshold, its animalistic eyes wild as its head jutted out into the hall. There was a pause then, a pause during which Dorian could have sworn that Selena and the creature looked at each other, and its wildness calmed, just for a moment, and then Selena moved. The sword flashed in the torchlight, and there was a squish of flesh and crunch of bone. The neck was too thick to sever in one blow, so before Dorian could draw another breath, she struck again. The head hit the ground with a thud. Black blood sprang from the severed neck, from the body that still stood paralyzed in the doorway. Shit, Dorian breathed. Shit! Selena moved again, slamming her sword down into the head, skewering it as if she thought it could still bite. Dorian was still spewing a steady stream of curses as Selena reached out to the bloody marks around the door and swiped a finger through one of them. The creature's headless body collapsed, the holding spell broken. It had barely finished falling before Selena made four strikes, three to sever the emaciated torso in two, and the fourth to stab through where its heart would be. His bile rose up again as she angled her blade a fifth time, prying open the chest cavity of the creature. Whatever she saw made her face go even paler. Dorian didn't want to look. With grim efficiency, she kicked the two human head through the threshold, sending it knocking into the withered corpse of the creature. Then she shut the iron door and traced a few more marks over that threshold that glowed and then faded. Selena faced him, but Dorian looked at the door again, now sealed. How long does that spell hold? He almost choked on the word. I don't know, she said, shaking her head. Until I remove the marks, I think. I don't think we can let anyone else know about this, he said carefully. She laughed, a bit wildly. Telling others, even Kael, would mean answering difficult questions. Questions that could earn them both a trip to the butchering block. So, Selena said, spitting blood onto the stones. Do you want to explain yourself first, or should I? Selena went first, because Dorian desperately needed to change his filthy tunic, and talking seemed like a good idea while he stripped naked in his dressing room. She sat on his bed, not looking much better herself, which is why they'd taken the dark servants' passages back to his tower. Beneath the library stretches an ancient dungeon, I think, Selena said, trying to keep her voice as soft as possible. She caught a gleam of golden skin through the half-open door to his dressing room and looked away. I think someone kept the creature in there until it broke out of its cell. It's been living under the library ever since. No need to tell him that she was starting to believe the king had created it. The clock tower had been built by the king himself, so he had to know what it connected to. She knew that the creature had been made because its chest had been a human heart. Selena was willing to bet that the king had used at least one word key to make both tower and monster. What I don't understand, Dorian said from the dressing room, is why this thing can now break through the iron doors when it couldn't before. Because I was an idiot and broke the spells on them when I walked through. A lie. Sort of. But she didn't want to explain, couldn't explain why the creature had been able to break out before and had never hurt anyone until now. Why it had been in the hallway that night and disappeared. Why the librarians were still all alive and unhurt. But perhaps the man that the creature had once been, perhaps he hadn't been entirely lost. There were so many questions now, so many things left unanswered. And that last spell you did, on the door, it'll keep forever? Dorian appeared in a new tunic and pants, still barefoot. The sight of his feet felt strangely intimate. She shrugged, fighting the urge to wipe her bloody, filthy face. He'd offered her his private bath, but she'd refused. That felt too intimate, too. The book says it's a permanent binding spell, so I don't think anyone but us will be capable of getting through. Unless the king wants to get in and uses one of the word keys. Dorian ran a hand through his hair, sitting down beside her on the bed. Where did it come from? I don't know, she lied. The king's ring flashed in her memory. That couldn't be the word key, though. Yellowlux had said they were slivers of black rock, not forged into shapes. But he could have made the ring using the key. She understood now why Archer and his society both coveted and sought to destroy it. If the king could use it to make creatures. If he had made more. There had been so many doors, well over 200, all locked, and both Keltane and Nehemia had mentioned wings, wings in their dreams, wings flapping through the Farian Gap. What was the king brewing there? Tell me, Dorian pressed. I don't know, she lied again, hating herself for it. How could she make him understand a truth that might shatter everything he loved? That book, Dorian said. How did you know it would help? I found it one day in the library. It seemed to trail me. Showed up in my rooms when I hadn't brought it there. Reappeared in the library. It was full of those kinds of spells. But it's not magic, Dorian said, paling. Not the magic that you have. This is different. I didn't even know if that spell would work. Speaking of which, she said, meeting his eyes, you have magic. He scanned her face, and she quelled the urge to fidget. What do you want me to say? Tell me how you have magic, she breathed. Tell me how you have it and the rest of the world doesn't. Tell me how you discovered it and what manner of magic it is. Tell me everything. He started to shake his head, but she leaned forward. You just saw me break at least a dozen of your father's laws. You think I'm going to turn you over to him when you could just as easily destroy me? Dorian sighed. After a moment, he said, A few weeks ago, I erupted. I got so mad at a council meeting that I stormed out and punched a wall. And somehow, stone cracked, and then the window nearby shattered too. Since then, I've been trying to figure out where it comes from, what kind of power it is, exactly, and how to control it. But it just happens. Like when you used it to stop me from killing Kaol. His neck bobbed as he swallowed hard. She couldn't meet his stare as she said, Thank you for that. If you hadn't stopped me, No matter what had happened between her and Kaol, no matter what she now felt for him, if she had killed him that night, there would have been no coming back from it, no recovering. In some ways, it might have made her into just another version of that thing in the library. It made her sick to even think about it. No matter what your magic might be, it saved more lives than his that night. Dorian shifted. I still need to learn to control it, or else it might happen anywhere, in front of anyone. I've gotten lucky so far, but I don't think that luck will last. Does anyone else know? Kaol? Roland? No, Kaol doesn't know, and Roland just left with Duke Parrington. They're going to Morath for a few months to oversee the situation in Eelway. It all had to be tied together. The king, the magic, Dorian's power, the word marks, even the creature. The prince went to his bed and hoisted up the mattress, pulling out a concealed book. Not the best hiding place, but a valiant effort. I've been looking through the genealogy charts for Adolin's noble families. We've hardly had any magic users in the past few generations. There were so many things she could tell him, but if she did, it would just result in too many questions. So Selena merely studied the pages he displayed for her, flipping through one after another. Wait, she said. The puncture wounds in her shoulder gave a burst of pain when she lifted her hand to the book. She scanned the pages he'd stopped on. She'd scanned the page he'd stopped on, her heart pounding as another clue about the king and his plan slipped into place. She let him continue on. See, Dorian said, closing the book, I'm not quite sure where it comes from. He was still watching her, warily. She met his gaze and said quietly, 10 years ago, many of the people I loved were executed for having magic. Pain and guilt flickered in his eyes, but she went on. So you'll understand when I say that I have no desire to see anyone else die for it, even the son of the man who ordered those deaths. I'm sorry, he said quietly. So what do we do now? Eat a giant meal, see a healer, take a bath. In that order. He snorted and playfully nudged her with a knee. She leaned forward, clasping her hands between her legs. We wait. We keep an eye on that door to make sure no one tries to go in and just take it day by day. He took one of her hands in his own, staring toward the window. Day by day. And that was chapter 44.
Cersei's being brave and bold now.
That's awesome.
She just ate. And to the other room.
Well, that doesn't surprise me. That other room is like her room, and she hasn't been able to go in it all day.
I think Mira's in there.
EC, thank you for the tier 1 prime sub. Wait, converted from a prime sub to a tier 1 sub. Well, thank you for the tier 1 sub. Well, hi, Sassy. Okay.
It's okay, Sassy. It's okay.
We're gonna move on to chapter 45. Selena didn't get a meal, or take a bath, or see a healer for her shoulder. Instead, she hurried to the dungeon, not even looking at the guards that she passed. Exhaustion ripped at her, but fear kept her moving, almost sprinting down the stairs. "They want to use me. They tricked me," Keltaine had said. And in Dorian's book of Adderland's noble lineages, the Rompier family had been listed as one with a strong magical line, supposedly vanished 2 generations ago. "Sometimes I think they brought me here," Keltaine had said. "Not to marry Parrington, but for another purpose." Brought Keltaine here, the way Cain had been brought here. Cain, of the White Fang Mountains, where powerful shamans had long ruled the tribes. Her mouth went dry as she strode down the dungeon hallway to Keltaine's cell. She stopped in front, staring through the bars. It was empty. All that was left inside was Selena's cloak, discarded in the kicked up hay, as if Keltaine had struggled against whoever had come to take her. Selena was at the guard station a moment later, pointing down the hall. "Where is Keltaine?" Even as she said it, a memory began to clear, a memory hazed by days spent sedated in the dungeons. The guards looked at each other, then at her torn and bloody clothes, before one said, "The Duke took her, to Morath, to be his wife." She stalked out of the dungeon, heading for her rooms. "Something is coming," Keltaine had whispered. "And I am to greet it. My headaches are worse every day, and full of all those flapping wings." Selena nearly stumbled on a step. "Roland has been suffering from awful headaches lately," Dorian had told her a few days ago. And now Roland, who shared Dorian Havilliard's blood, had gone to Morath too. Gone? Or been taken? Selena touched her shoulder and felt the open, bloody wounds beneath. The creature had been clawing at its head, as though it were in pain. And when it had shoved through the door, for those last few seconds it had been frozen in place, she had seen something human in its warped eyes. Something that looked so relieved, so grateful for the death she gave him. "Who were you?" she whispered, recalling the human heart and the man-like body of the creature under the library. "And what did he do to you?" But Selena had a feeling she already knew the answer, because that was the other thing the word keys could do, the other power that the word marks controlled. Life. "They hear wings in the Farian Gap," Nehemia had said. "Our scouts do not come back." The king was twisting far worse things than mortal men. Far, far worse things. But what did he plan to do with them? With the creatures? With the people like Roland and Keltaine? She needed to learn how many of the word keys he had found, and where the others might be. The next night, Selena examined the door to the library catacombs, her ears straining for any hint of sound on the other side. Nothing. The bloody word marks had turned flaky, but beneath the crust, as if welded onto the metal, was the dark outline of each mark. From high, high above, the muffled bellow of the clock tower sounded. It was 2 in the morning. How did no one know that this tower sat atop an ancient dungeon that served as the king's own secret chamber? Selena glowered at the door in front of her, because who would even think about that possibility? She knew she should go to bed, but she'd been unable to sleep for weeks now, and saw no point in even trying anymore. It was why she'd come down here, to do something while sorting through her jumbled thoughts. She flipped the dagger in her right hand, angling it, and gave a light, tentative tug on the door. It held. She paused, listened again for any signs of life, and yanked harder. It didn't budge. Selena pulled a few more times, going so far as to brace a foot against the wall, but the door remained sealed. When she was at last convinced that nothing was getting through the door, in either direction, she loosed a long breath. No one would believe her about this place, just like no one would believe her wild, highly unlikely story about the word keys. To find the word keys, she'd first have to solve the riddle, and then convince the king to let her go for a few months. Years. It would take careful manipulation, especially since it seemed likely that he already had a key. But which one? They hear wings. Yolilik said that they only combined could that only combined could the three open the actual word gate, but alone each still wielded immense power. What other sorts of terrors could he create? If he got all three word keys, what might he bring into Aurelia to serve him? Things were already stirring on the continent. Unrest was brewing. She had a feeling that he wouldn't tolerate it for long. No, it would only be a matter of time before he unleashed whatever he'd been creating upon them all, and crush all resistance forever. Selena looked at the sealed door, her stomach turning. A half-dried pool of blood lay at the base of the door, so dark it looked like oil. She crouched, swiping a finger through the puddle. She sniffed at it, almost gagged at the rake, and then rubbed her finger against the pad of her thumb. It felt as oily as it looked. She got to her feet and reached into her pocket, looking for something to wipe off her fingers. She drew out a handful of papers. Scraps was more like it. Bits of things that she'd carried around to study whenever she had a spare moment. Frowning, she shifted through them to sort out which she could spare to use as a makeshift handkerchief. One was just a receipt for a pair of shoes, which she must have accidentally tucked into her pocket that morning. And another, Selena lifted that one closer. Ah, Time's Rift had been written there. She'd scribbled it down when she'd been trying to solve the eye riddle. When everything in the tomb had felt like a great secret, one giant clue. Some help that had been. Just another dead end. Cursing under her breath, she used it to wipe the grime off her fingers. The tomb still didn't make sense, though. What did the trees on the ceiling and the stars on the floor have to do with the riddle? The stars had led to the secret hole, but they could just as easily have been on the ceiling to do that. Why make everything backward? Would Brandon have been so foolish as to put all the answers in one place? She uncrumpled the scrap of paper, now stained with the creature's oily blood. Ah, Time's Rift. There was no inscription at Gavin's feet, only Elena's, and the words made little sense. But what if they weren't meant to make sense? What if they were only just logical enough to imply one thing, but really mean another? Everything in the tomb was backward, rearranged, the natural order in reverse, to hint that things were jumbled, misarranged. So the thing that should have been concealed was right in the open. But, like everything else, its meaning was warped. And there was one person, one being, who could possibly tell her whether she was right. That was chapter 45. On to chapter 46. It's an anagram, she panted as she reached the tomb. Mort opened an eye. Clever, wasn't it? To hide it right where everyone could see? Selena eased open the door, just wide enough to slip inside. The moonlight was strong, and her breath caught in her throat as she saw precisely where it fell. Trembling, she stopped at the foot of the sarcophagus and traced her fingers over the stone letters. Tell me what it means. He paused, long enough for her to take a deep breath to start yelling at him, but he then said, I am the first. And that was all the confirmation she needed. The first word key of the three. Selena moved around the stone body, her eyes on Elena's sleeping face. As she looked upon those fine features, she whispered the words. In grief he hid one in the crown of her he loved so well, to keep with her where she lay down inside the sorry cell. She lifted shaking fingers to the blue jewel in the center of the crown. If this was indeed the word key, what would she do with it? Would she be forced to destroy it? Where could she hide it so no one else would discover it? The questions swirled, threatening with all the difficulty they offered to send her running back to her rooms, but she steeled herself. She'd considered everything later. I will not be afraid, she told herself. The gem in the crown glowed in the moonlight, and she gingerly pushed against one side of the jewel. It didn't move. She pushed again, staying closer to the side, digging her nail into the slight crease between the gem and the stone rim. It shifted. And turned over to reveal a small compartment beneath. It was no larger than a coin and no deeper than a knuckle's length. Selena peered in. The moonlight revealed only gray stone. She stuck a finger inside, scraping every surface. There was nothing there, not even a shard. A shot of cold ran down her spine. So he truly has it, she whispered. He found the key before me, and he's been using its power for his own agenda. He was barely 20 when he found it, Mort said softly. Strange, bellicose youth. Always poking around in forgotten places where he wasn't wanted, reading books no one his age, or any age, should read. Though, Mort added. That does sound awfully like someone I know. And you somehow forgot to tell me until now? I didn't know what it was then. I thought he merely took something. It wasn't until you read the riddle that I suspected. It was a good thing he was made of bronze. Otherwise, she'd have smashed his face in. Do you have any suspicions about what he might have done with it? She turned the gem back over as she fought her rising terror. How should I know? He never said anything to me. Though, I'll admit, I didn't condescend to speak with him. He came back here once he was king, but he only poked around for a few minutes and then left. I suspect he was looking for the other two keys. How did he discover it was here? She asked, stepping away from the marble figure. The same way you did, though far faster. I suppose that makes him cleverer than you. Do you think he has the other two? She said, eyeing the treasure along the far wall, the stand where Damaris was displayed. Why hadn't he taken Damaris, one of the greatest heirlooms of this house? If he had the others, do you think that our doom would have come upon us already? Don't you think that our doom would have come upon us already? You think he doesn't have all the keys? She asked, beginning to sweat despite the cold. Well, Brandon once told me that if you have all three keys, then you have control over the word gate. I think it's fair to assume that the current king would have tried his hand at conquering another realm, or enslaved creatures to conquer the rest of ours if he had all three. Word save us if that happens. Word? Mort laughed. You're pleading with the wrong force. If he controls the word, you're going to have to find another means of saving yourself. And don't you think it's too much of a coincidence that magic stopped as soon as he began his conquest? How magic stopped? He used the word key to stifle magic? All magic? She added. But his own. And by extension, Dorian's. She swore, then asked. So you think he might also have the second word key? I don't think a person could eliminate magic with only one. Though I might be wrong. No one really knows what they're capable of. Selena pressed the heels of her palms into her eyes. Oh gods, this is what Elena wanted me to learn. And now what am I supposed to do? Go hump the third one down? Steal the other two from him? Nehemia, you had to have known. You must have had a plan. But what were you going to do? The now familiar abyss inside of her stretched wider. There was no end to it, that hollow ache. No end at all. If the gods had bothered to listen, she would have traded her life for Nehemia's. It would have been such an easy choice to make, because the world didn't need an assassin with a coward's heart. It needed someone like Nehemia. But there was no gods left to bargain with, no one to offer her soul in exchange for another moment with Nehemia, just one more chance to talk to her, to hear her voice. Yet, maybe she didn't need the gods to talk to Nehemia. Cain had summoned the Ritterrack, and he certainly hadn't possessed a word key. No, Nehemia had said there were spells to open a temporary portal, just long enough for something to slip through. If Cain could do that, if Selena could use the marks to freeze the catacombs creature in place and permanently seal a door, then couldn't marks open a portal to get another realm? Her chest tightened. If there were other realms, realms where the dead dwelled, in torment or in peace, who was to say that she couldn't speak to Nehemia? She could do it. No matter the cost, it would only be for a moment, just long enough to ask Nehemia where the king was keeping the keys, or how to find the third, and to find out what else Nehemia might have known. She could do it. There were other things she needed to tell Nehemia, too. Words she needed to say, truths she needed to confess, and that goodbye, that final goodbye that she hadn't been allowed to make. Selena took Damaris off its stand again. Mort, how long do you think a portal can stay open? Whatever you're thinking, whatever you are going to do right now, stop it! But Selena was already walking out of the tomb. He didn't understand, couldn't understand. She had lost and lost and lost, been denied countless goodbyes, but not this time. Not when she could change all of that, even for a few minutes. This time, it would be different. She'd need the Walking Dead, another dagger or two, some candles, and space. More space than the tomb could offer. The drawings that Cain had made had taken up a fair amount of room. There was a large passage one level up in the secret tunnels, a long hallway, and a set of doors she never dared to open. The hallway was wide, its ceiling high. Enough room to cast a spell. For her to open a portal into an other world. Dorian knew he was dreaming. He was standing in an ancient stone chamber he'd never seen before, facing a tall, crowned warrior. The crown was familiar somehow, but it was the man's eyes that stunned him into an action. They were his own eyes, sapphire, blazing. The similarities ended there. The man had shoulder-length dark brown hair, an angular, almost cruel face, and was at least a hand taller than Dorian himself, and he carried himself like a king. Prince, the man said, his golden crown gleaming. There was something feral in his eyes, as if the king was more accustomed to roaming the wilderness than walking these marble halls. You must awaken. Why? Doreen asked, not sounding very princely at all. Strange green symbols were glowing on the gray stones, similar to the symbol Selena had made in the library. What was this place? Because a line that should never be crossed is about to be breached. It puts this entire castle in jeopardy, and the life of your friend. His voice wasn't harsh, but Doreen had a sense it could turn that way, if provoked. Which, judging by the ancient wildness, the arrogance, and the challenge in the king's eyes, seemed like a fairly easy thing to do. Doreen said, "What are you talking about? Who are you?" "Don't waste time with pointless questions." Yes, this king wasn't one to mince words at all. "You must go to her rooms. There is a door hidden behind a tapestry. Take the third passage on the right. Go now, prince, or lose her forever." And somehow, Doreen didn't think twice about the fact that Gavin, first king of Adderlin, had spoken to him as he woke, yanked on his clothes, grabbed his sword belt, and sprinted from his tower. And that was chapter 46. On to chapter 47. The cut on her arm throbbed, but Selena kept her hand steady as she dipped her finger again into her blood and traced the word mark on the wall, copying the symbols in the book with perfect precision. They formed an archway, a door, and her blood gleamed in the light of the candles as she had brought. Candles she had brought. It had to be perfect. Each symbol had to be flawless, or else it wouldn't work. She kept pressing on the wound to keep it from clotting. Not everyone could harness the marks. No, the Walking Dead said there had to be power in the blood to do it. Cain had clearly had some trace of power. That must be why the king had rounded up Caltaine and Roland too. He'd used the word keys to suppress magic, but he must have some way of harnessing the innate power in someone's blood, and the word marks must be able to access that power too. She drew another symbol, nearly finished with the archway. Their power could warp things. It had warped Cain, but it also allowed him to summon the Ritterrack and gain even more power for himself. Thank the word, Cain was dead. There was one mark left to draw, the one that would bring her to the person she so desperately needed to see, if only for a moment. It was complex, a weave of loops and angles. She took out her chalk and practiced on the floor until she got it right, then etched it in blood on the wall, Nehemia's name in word mark form. She examined the door she'd drawn and got to her feet, the book held in her clean hand. She cleared her throat and began to read the words on the page. She didn't know the language. Her throat burned and contracted, as if fighting the sounds, but she panted through it, the words making her teeth ache like she'd just come in from the cold and was drinking something hot. And then, the final words were out, her eyes watering. No wonder this kind of power fell out of favor. The symbols written in her blood began to glow green, one after another, until the whole archway was a line of light. The stones within its borders darkened, 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 then disappeared. The blackness within the green archway seemed to reach out for her. It had worked. Holy gods, it had worked. Was that what waited for her when she died? Nehemia had gone here? Nehemia? She whispered, her throat raw from the spell. There was nothing. Nothing there. Just a void. Selena looked at the book, then to the wall, and the symbols she'd drawn. She'd written it correctly. The spell was right. Nehemia? She whispered towards the endless dark. There was no response. Perhaps it needed time. The book hadn't specified how long it would take. Maybe Nehemia had to travel through whatever this realm was. So Selena waited. The longer she stared into that endless void, the more it seemed to stare back. It was just like that dream, that one where she was standing on the edge of that ravine. You are nothing more than a coward. Please, Selena whispered into the dark. There was a sudden yelp from far, far above, and Selena whirled toward the stairs at the end of the hall. Moments later, faster than should be possible, Fleetfoot bounded down the steps, racing for her. Not for her, Selena realized, as she beheld the wagging tail, the panting, the yip of what could only be joy. Not for her, because... Selena looked toward the portal at the same moment Fleetfoot skidded to a halt, and then everything stopped as she beheld the shimmering figure standing just on the other side of the portal. Fleetfoot lay on the ground, tail still wagging, whining softly. The edges of Nehemia's body rippled and blurred, fracturing with some sort of inner light. But her face was clear. It was her face. Selena sank to her knees. She felt the warmth of her tears before she realized she was crying. I'm sorry, was all she could say. I'm so sorry. But Nehemia remained on the other side of the portal. Fleetfoot whined again. I may not cross this line, Nehemia said gently to the dog, and neither may you. Her tone shifted, and Selena knew Nehemia was now staring at her. I thought you were smarter than this. Selena looked up, the light radiating off the princess didn't reach through the glowing portal, as if there truly was some sort of line, some final boundary. "I'm sorry," Selena whispered again. "I just wanted..." "There was no time for you to tell me what you longed to say. I came here because you need to be warned. Do not open this portal again. The next time you do, I will not be the one who answers your call, and you will not survive the encounter. No one has the right to open the door to this realm, no matter how fierce their grief." She hadn't known, hadn't meant. Fleetfoot pawed at the floor. "Goodbye, my dear friend," Nehemia had said to the dog, and began walking into the blackness. Selena just stood there, unable to move or think, her throat burned with those pent-up words, the words that now choked the life out of her. "Alentia," Nehemia paused to look back at her. The void seemed to be swirling, swallowing her up bit by bit. "You will not understand yet, but I knew what my fate was to be, and I embraced it. I ran toward it. Because it was the only way for things to begin changing, for events to be set in motion. But no matter what I did, Alentia, I want you to know that it is in the darkness of the past 10 years, you were one of the bright lights for me. Do not let that light go out." And before Selena could reply, the princess was gone. There was nothing in the dark, as though Nehemia had never been, as though she'd made it all up. "Come back," she whispered. "Please come back." But the darkness remained the same, and Nehemia was gone. There was a scrape of footsteps, but not from the portal. Rather, it came from the left. From Archer, who stood there gaping. "I don't believe it," he whispered. And that was chapter 47. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I felt my phone vibrating and I wanted to make sure it wasn't... It is a text. Hold on, I have to respond. It's a text from the adoption person. Okay.
"I'm sorry I made a sound. You can lay back down."
Wait, let me get some water. On to chapter 48. Selena had Damaris drawn and leveled at Archer in a heartbeat. Fleetfoot growled at him, but kept back, a step behind Selena. "What are you doing here?" It was inconceivable that he'd be here. How had he gotten in? "I've been tracking you for weeks," Archer said, eyeing the dog. "Nehemia told me about the passages, showed me the way in. I've been down here almost every night since she died." Selena glanced at the portal. If Nehemia had warned her not to open the portal, then she was certain her friend didn't want Archer seeing it either. She moved to the wall, keeping well away from the blackness as she ran her hand over the glowing green marks, making to wipe them away. "What are you doing?" Archer demanded. Selena pointed Damaris at him, furiously wiping at the marks. They didn't budge. Whatever this spell was, it was far more complex than the one that had sealed the library door. Merely swiping away the marks wouldn't undo it. But Archer now stood between her and the book where she had the closing spell flagged. Selena rubbed harder. It was all terribly wrong. "Stop!" Archer lunged, getting past her guard with unnatural ease, as he grasped her wrist. Fleetfoot barked a ferocious warning, but a sharp whistle from Selena had the dog staying well away. She whirled to Archer, already making to dislocate the arm that held her, but the green light of the portal illuminated the plane of his wrist, where the sleeve of his tunic had fallen back. A black tattoo of some snake-like creature appeared there. She'd seen that before, seen it. Selena raised her eyes to his face. "Do not trust." She had thought Nehemia's drawing had been of the royal seal, a slightly warped version of the wyvern, but it had actually been of this tattoo, of Archer's tattoo. "Do not trust Archer," she'd been trying to tell her. Selena shoved back from him, drawing a dagger. She pointed both Damaris and the knife at him. How much had Nehemia hidden from Archer and his contacts? If she didn't trust them, then why had she told them all that she did? Tell me how you learned this, Archer whispered, his eyes going back to the portal and the darkness beyond. Please, did you find the word keys? Is that how you did it? What do you know of the word keys? She got out. Where are they? Where did you find them? I don't have the keys. You found the riddle, though, Archer panted. I let you find that riddle I hid in Davis's office. It took us 5 years to find that riddle, and you must have solved it. I know you'd be the one to solve it. Nehemia knew, too. Selena was shaking her head. He didn't know that there had been a second riddle, a riddle with a map to the keys. The king has at least one key, but where the other two are, I don't know. Archer's eyes darkened. We suspected that much. That was why she came here in the first place, to learn where whether he'd actually stolen them, and if so, how many. That was why Nehemia couldn't leave, she realized. Why she'd opted to stay here instead of returning to Ilwe, to fight for the one thing that was more important than the fate of her country. The fate of the world. Of other worlds, too. I don't have to get on a ship tomorrow. We'll tell everyone, Archer breathed. We'll tell everyone he has them and... No! If we reveal the truth, then the king will use the keys to do more damage than you can possibly imagine. We'll lose any chance of stealth we have to find the others. He took a step closer to her. Fleetfoot let out another warning growl, but kept her distance. Then we'll find where he's keeping the key, and the others, and then we'll use them to overthrow him. Then we'll create a world of our own making. His voice was building into a frenzy, each word harsher than the next. She shook her head. I would sooner destroy them than use their power. Archer chuckled. She said the same thing. Said they should be destroyed, put back in the gate, if we could discover a way. But what is the point of finding them if we don't use them against him? Make him suffer? Her stomach turned. There was more he wasn't saying, more that he knew. So she sighed and shook her head, beginning to pace. Archer was silent as she walked, silent till she halted, as if suddenly understanding. She raised her voice. He should suffer for as long as possible, and so should the people who destroyed us, who made us into what we are. Arabin, Clarice... She chewed on her lip. Nehemia could never understand that. She never tried to. You're right. They should be used. He studied her warily enough that she came closer and tilted her head to the side, contemplating his words. Contemplating him. And Archer bought it. That was why she left the movement. She left a week before she died. We knew it was a matter of time before she went to the king to expose us all, to use what she'd learned to grant clemency to Ilwe, and to annihilate us with the same stroke. She said she'd rather have one all-powerful tyrant than a dozen of them. Selena said with deadly calm, She would have ruined everything for you. She almost ruined everything for me, too. She told me to stay away from the word keys. She tried to keep me from solving the riddle. Because she wanted to keep the knowledge to herself, for her own gain. Selena smiled, even as she felt the world shifting beneath her. And she couldn't explain why or how she began to wonder, but if it was true, she had to get him to admit it. She found herself saying, You and I worked for everything we have. We had everything taken away and used against us, too. Other people can't even begin to fathom the things we were forced to do. I think that's why I was so infatuated with you when I was a girl. I knew, even then, that you understood. That you knew what it was like to be raised by people like Arabin and Clarice. And then sold. You understood me then. She willed her eyes to gleam, her mouth to tighten as if she were keeping it from wobbling. Blinking furiously, she murmured, But I think I finally understand you now, too. She reached out a hand as if to grab his, but lowered it, making her face tender and soft and bittersweet. Why didn't you tell me sooner? We could have been working toward this for weeks. We could have tried to solve the riddle together. If I'd known what Nehemia was going to do, how she could lie to me again and again, she betrayed me. In every possible way, Archer. She lied to my face, made me believe. Her shoulders slumped. After a long moment, she took a step toward him. Nehemia was no better than Arabin or Clarice in the end. Archer, you should have told me about everything. I knew it wasn't Mullison. He wasn't smart enough. If you'd told me, I could have taken care of it. A risk, a leap of faith. For you, for us, I would have taken care of it. But Archer gave her a hesitant smile. She spent so much time complaining about Councilman Mullison, that I knew he'd be the easiest one to blame. And thanks to that competition, he already had a connection to Grave. Grave didn't recognize that you weren't Mollison? She asked as calmly as she could. You'd be surprised how easily men see what they want to see. A cloak, a mask, and some fine clothes, and he didn't think twice. Oh, gods. Gods. So the night in the warehouse, she went on, raising an eyebrow, an intrigued co-conspirator. Why did you really kidnap Kael? I had to get you away from Nehemia. And when I took that arrow for you, I knew you'd trust me. If only for that night. I apologize if my methods were harsh. Trick of the trade, I'm afraid. Trust him, lose Nehemia, and lose Kaol. He had isolated her from her friends, the same thing she suspected Roland had wanted to do with Dorian. And that threat the king received before Nehemia's death, the threat on her life, Selena said, her lips curling upward. You planted that threat, didn't you? To show me who my real friends are, who I can really trust. It was a gamble, but just as I'm gambling now. I didn't know whether or not the captain would warn you. Seems I was right. Why me? I'm flattered, of course, but you're clever. Why couldn't you have figured the riddle out on your own? Archer bowed his head. Because I know what you are, Selena. Arabin told me one night, after you went to Indovier. She shoved the twinge of genuine pain and betrayal down until it couldn't distract her. And for our cause to succeed, we need you. I need you. Some members of the movement are already starting to fight me, to question my leadership. They think my methods are too rough. That explained the fight she'd seen with the young man. He took a step toward her. But you, gods, from the moments I saw you outside the willows, I've known how good we'd be together. The things we'll accomplish. I know, she said, looking into those green eyes, so bright in the matching lights of the portal. Archer, I know. He didn't see the dagger coming until she'd shoved it into him. But he was fast, too fast, and turned just in time to have it pierce his shoulder instead of his heart. He staggered back with dazzling speed, wrenching her dagger so swiftly that she lost her grip on the blade and had to brace a hand on the arch of the portal to keep from stumbling. Her bloodied palm slapped against the stones, and a greenish light flared beneath her fingers. A word mark burned, then faded. Not giving herself time to look at what she'd done, she leapt for him with a roar, dropping to Marison to grab two more daggers. He had his own blade up in a moment, dancing away lightly as she sliced for him. I'm going to tear you apart piece by piece, she hissed, circling him. But then a shudder ran through the floor, and something in the void made a sound, a guttural growl. Fleetfoot let out a low, warning whine. She rushed toward Selena, pushing against her shins, herding her toward the stairs. The void shifted, mist now swirling inside, parting long enough to reveal rocky, ashen ground. And then a figure emerged through the mist. Nehemia? She whispered. She'd come back to help, to explain everything. But it was not Nehemia who stepped through the portal. Kaol couldn't sleep. He stared up at the canopy of his bed, the will he'd seen on Selena's desk glaring in his mind. He couldn't stop thinking about it. He just let her kick him out of her rooms without telling her what the will meant to him. And maybe he deserved her hate, but she had to know that he didn't want her money. He had to see her. Just long enough to explain. He ran a finger down the scab along his cheek. Rushing footsteps sounded down the hall, and Kaol was already out of bed and half-dressed by the time someone began pounding on his door. The person on the other side got all of one knock in before Kaol flung the door open, a dagger concealed behind his back. He lowered the blade the second he beheld Dorian's face, shining with sweat. But he didn't sheathe it. Not when he saw the raw panic in Dorian's eyes, the sword belt and scabbard dangling from the prince's clutched fingers. Kaol believed in trusting his instinct, and he didn't think humans had survived for so long without developing some ability to tell when things were wrong. It wasn't magic, it was just gut feeling. And it was Kaol's instinct that told him who this was about before Dorian opened his mouth. Where? Was all Kaol had asked. Her bedroom, Dorian said. Tell me everything, Kaol ordered, hurrying back into his rooms. I don't know. I think she's in trouble. Kaol was already shrugging on a shirt and tunic. Then he stomped his feet into his boots before grabbing his sword. What kind of trouble? The kind that had me coming to get you instead of the other guards. That could mean anything, but Kaol knew Dorian was too smart, too aware of how easily words could be overheard in this castle. He sensed the tightening in Dorian's body a heartbeat before the prince launched into a run and grabbed him by the back of his tunic. Running, Kaol said under his breath, will attract attention. I already wasted too much time coming to get you. Dorian retorted, but he matched Kaol's brisk but calm pace. It would take 5 minutes to get to her rooms if they kept the speed, if there were no distractions. Is anyone hurt? Kaol said quietly, trying to keep his breathing even, his face focused. I don't know, Dorian said. You have to give me more than that, Kaol snapped, the leash on his temper strained with each step. I had a dream, Dorian said, so softly only he could hear. I was warned that she was in danger, that she was a danger to herself. Kaol almost stopped, but Dorian had said it with such conviction. You think I wanted to come get you? Dorian said, not looking at him. Kael didn't reply, but hurried his steps as much as he could without attracting undue attention from the servants and guards still on duty. He could feel his heart hammering through every inch of his body by the time they got to her suite doors. Kael didn't bother knocking and nearly took the front door off its hinges as he burst through, Dorian on his heels. He was at her bedroom door in an instant and didn't bother knocking on it either, but the handle didn't move. The door was locked. He shoved into it again. Selena, her name was more of a growl that rippled out of him. No answer. He fought his rising panic, even as he drew a dagger, even as he listened for any signs of trouble. Selena! Nothing. Kael waited all of a second before he slammed his shoulder into the door. Once. Twice. The lock snapped. The door burst open, revealing her empty bedroom. Holy God, Dorian whispered. The tapestry on the wall had been folded back to reveal an open door, a secret stone door that opened into a dark passage. It was how she'd gotten out to kill Grave. Dorian drew his sword from the scabbard. In my dream, I was told I would find this door. The prince stepped forward, but Kael stopped him with an arm. He'd think about Dorian and his clairvoyant dreams later, much later. You're not going down there. Dorian's eyes flashed. Like hell I'm not. As if in answer, a guttural bone-grinding growl sounded from within, and then a scream, a human scream, followed by a high-pitched bark. Kael was running for the passage before he could think. It was pitch black, and Kael almost tumbled down the stairs, but Dorian, close behind, grabbed a candle. Stay upstairs, Kael ordered, still charging down. If he had had time, he would have locked Dorian in the closet rather than risk bringing the Crown Prince into danger. But what the hell had that growl been? The bark, he knew. The bark was Fleetfoot. And if Fleetfoot was down there, Dorian kept following him. I was sent here, he said. Kael took the stairs by twos and threes, hardly hearing the prince's words. Had that scream been hers? It had sounded male, but who else could it be down here with her? Blue light flashed in the bottom of the stairs. What was that? A roar shook the ancient stones. That was not human, nor was it Fleetfoot. But what? They had never found the creature that had been killing the champions. The murders had just stopped. But the damage he'd seen to those corpses. No, Selena had to be alive. Please, he begged any gods who would listen. Kael leapt onto the landing and found three doorways. The blue light had flashed from the right. They ran. How had such a massive cavern of chambers been forgotten, and how long had she known about them? He flew down a spiral staircase, and then a new, greenish light began shining steadily, and he turned onto a landing to see. He didn't know where to look first, at the long hallway where one wall glowed with an arch of green symbols, or at the world that showed through the arch, depicting a land of mist and rock. At Archer, cowering against the opposite wall, chanting strange words from a book he held in his hands. At Selena, prostrate on the floor. Or at the monster, a tall, sinewy thing, but definitely not human, not with those unnaturally long fingers tipped with claws, white skin that looked like crumpled paper, a distended jaw that revealed fish-like teeth, and those eyes, milky and tinged with blue. And there was Fleetfoot, hackles raised and fangs bared, refusing to let the demon anywhere near Selena, even as the half-grown pup limped, even as the blood pooled from the wound in her right behind leg. Kael had all of two heartbeats to size up the monster, to take in every detail, to mark his surroundings. Go! He snarled at Dorian before launching himself at the creature.
Oh dear gosh.
And that was chapter 48. This bitch, exactly. Okay, chapter 49 is small enough, we can quickly go through that. What? Chapter 49. She didn't remember anything after the first two swings of her sword, only that she'd suddenly seen Fleetfoot come flying out of the creature. The sight had distracted her enough for the demon to get past her guard, its long, white fingers grabbing her by her hair and slamming her head into the wall. Then darkness. She wondered whether she died and awoken in hell as she opened her eyes to a pulsing headache, and the sight of Kael circling the pale demon, blood dripping from both of them. And then there were cool hands on her head, on her neck, and Dorian crouching in front of her as he said, "Selena." She struggled to her feet, her head aching even more. She had to help Kael, had to... She heard a rip of clothing and a yelp of pain, and she looked at Kale in time to see him grasp the cut on his shoulder. Inflicted by those filthy, jagged nails, the creature roared, its overlong jaw gleaming with saliva, and it lunged again for the captain. Selena tried to move, but she wasn't fast enough. But Dorian was. Something invisible slammed into the creature, sending it flying into the wall with a crunch. Gods! Dorian didn't just have magic. He had raw magic, the rarest and deadliest kind. Sheer, undiluted power, capable of being shaped into whatever the wielder desired. Whatever form the wielder desired. The creature crumpled, but instantly got up, whirling toward her and Dorian. The prince just stood there, hand outstretched. The milky blue eyes were ravenous now. Through the portal, Selena heard the rocky earth crunching beneath more pairs of blue, pale feet. Archer's chanting grew louder. Kale attacked the thing again. It surged toward him just before his sword struck, swiping with those long fingers, forcing the captain to dart back. She grabbed Dorian. We have to close it. The portal should close on its own eventually, but the longer it's open, the greater the threat of more coming through before it does. How? I don't know. Her head spun so badly, her knees wobbled, but she turned to Archer, who stood across the hall, separated from them by the pacing creature. Give me the book. Kale wounded the demon across its abdomen with a sure, deft stroke, but it didn't slow down. Even from a few feet away, the tang of the dark blood reached her nose. Selena watched Archer take it all in, his eyes wide, panicked beyond reason, and then he sprinted down the hall, taking with him the book and any hope of shutting the portal. Dorian couldn't move fast enough to stop the handsome man from playing with the book in his hands, and didn't dare, with that demon between them. Selena, her forehead bleeding, made a lunge for him, but the man was too fast. Her eyes kept darting to Kale, who was keeping the thing distracted. Dorian knew without being told that she didn't want to leave the captain. "I'll go," Dorian began. "No, he's dangerous, and these tunnels are a labyrinth," she panted. Kale and the creature circled each other, and the thing slowly backing toward the portal entrance. "I can't close it without that book," she moaned. "There are more books upstairs, but I..." "Then we flee," Dorian breathed, grabbing her by the elbow. "We flee and try to get those books. Try to get to those books." He dragged her with him, not daring to take his eyes off of Kale or the creature. She swayed in his grasp. The wound to her head must be bad as it looked. Shush. Something was glowing at her throat. The amulet she told him was just a cheap replica, shining it like a tiny blue star. "Go," Kale told them, staring down the thing in front of him. "Now!" She stumbled, tugging toward Kale, but Dorian pulled her back. "No!" she got out, but the wound to her head made her sag in Dorian's grip. As if realizing that she'd be a hindrance to Kale, she stopped fighting Dorian as he hauled her toward the stairs. Kale knew he couldn't win this fight. His best option was to flee with them, to guard the way until they could get to that stone door far, far above, and lock the creature down here. But he wasn't sure he'd even make it to the stairs. The creature thwarted his attack so easily it seemed to have an uncanny intelligence. At least Selena and Dorian had reached the stairs. He could accept his end if it meant they could escape. He could embrace the darkness when it came. The creature paused just long enough for Kale to gain a few more feet of distance. He backed toward the bottom step. But then she started shouting, the same word again and again, as Dorian tried to keep dragging her up the stairs. Fleetfoot. Kale looked. In a dark shadow by the wall, Fleetfoot had been left behind, her leg too injured to run. The creature looked too. And there was nothing he could do, absolutely nothing, as the creature whirled, grabbed Fleetfoot by her injured hind leg, and dragged her through the portal with it. There was nothing he could do, he realized, except run. Selena's scream was still echoing through the passageway as Kale leapt off the stairs and hurtled through the misty portal after Fleetfoot. If she had thought she'd known fear and pain before, it was nothing compared to what went through her when Kale ran through the portal after Fleetfoot. Dorian didn't see her coming as she whirled, slamming his head into the stone wall hard enough that he crumpled to the steps, freeing from his grip. But she didn't care about Dorian, didn't care about anything except Fleetfoot and Kale as she sprinted down those few stairs and across the hall. She had to get them out, get them back before the portal shut forever. She was through in a heartbeat, and when she saw Kale shielding Fleetfoot with nothing but his bare hands, his discarded sword snapped in two by the demon who hovered over them, she didn't think twice before she unleashed the monster inside herself. From the corner of his eye, Kale saw her coming, the ancient sword in her hands and her face set with feral rage. The moment she burst through the portal, something changed. It was like a fog vanished from her face, her features sharpening, her steps becoming longer and more graceful, and then her ears. Her ears shifted into delicate points. The creature, sensing it was about to lose its prey, made a final lunge for Kael. It was blasted away by a wall of blue flame. The fire vanished to reveal the creature slamming into the ground, flipping again and again. It was on its feet before it finished rolling, whirling towards Selena in the same move. She was between them now, sword raised. She roared, revealing elongated canines, and the sound that was unlike anything he'd ever heard. There was nothing human to it. Because she wasn't human, Kael realized, gaping up at her from where he still crouched over Fleetfoot. No, she wasn't human at all. Selena was Fae. And that is the end of chapter 49 and where we will be stopping for the night. My mom is not very happy with this cliffhanger. But anyways, I hope you guys have had a good time tonight.